السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وإيمانا وتقا وإحسانا يا رب العالمين اللهم اجعل أعمالنا كلها صالحة ولوجهك خالصة ولا تجعل لأحد منه شيئا Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and may Allah's peace and blessings be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam His noble companions and the tabi'un, the tabu'ut tabi'een and all the Muslim believers who live until the day of judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all our good intentions and deeds and reward us for every single moment we spend for His sake in order to gain His pleasure. And studying the Quran, which is Allah's words, which is Allah's message to humanity, is one of the noblest of deeds that man can engage in. So therefore, we are surely going to be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all our deeds and grant us great rewards. Ameen. Let us begin by reciting some of the verses that we are going to go through today, which is from Surah Ar-Rahman.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان جودان والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان ألا تطغوا في وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان والأرض وضعها للأنام فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام والحب ذو العصف والريحان فبأي آلاء خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار وخلق الجان من مارج خارج من نار فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان.
صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين. Surah Ar-Rahman, as we mentioned to you all last week, is a surah that is related to the two surahs that come before and after it. And as we have already gone through the surah that comes following this surah, which is Surah Al-Waqiyah, we know that that surah, Surah Al-Waqiyah, deals with the same subjects and themes that is dealt with in this surah. So we know that that surah spoke about the Quran. It spoke about the different categories of people who will be there on the day of judgment, depending on how they lived in this world, and about Allah's signs on earth, about His power, about His greatness, and all of His creations which reflect His power, His might, and His blessings upon human beings. And finally, it reminds us of the nature, the reality of this world. So these are the same things that are dealt with in Surah Ar-Rahman. Surah Ar-Rahman, but we saw that it will be in the opposite direction. Allah begins by speaking about the Quran and then about His ayah, about His miracle, signs in universe. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention about the people of Jahannam and the people of Al-Jannah. So last week we spoke about the verses that were conveying the message of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed His favor upon mankind by not only creating him, but also by giving him the ability of expression, of expressing Himself. And above all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided him by revealing the Quran. And He has sent His messenger, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in order to teach the Quran to mankind. So this shows Allah's grace, how much He is concerned in matters of His servants. How much Allah likes, desires to see us obeying Him and living a righteous life on this world. Allah wants to see us being obedient servants. And because of that, He has guided us as to how we should lead our lives in this world. So, you look at the first four verses, we see Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Quran, Khalaqa al-Insan, Allamahu al-Bayan. So we said that the word Ar-Rahman, with which this surah begins, is one of Allah's attributes and one of His Asma'ul Husna. But this attribute is something that we have to clearly understand. Because when you see Ar-Rahman, it does not just mean Allah's grace or Allah's mercy, but it means Allah's complete care. Allah's complete care for His servants, and that this care has no limits. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will continuously care for His creations. Will continuously care for His creations. So if you read this surah, you will find that all that has been mentioned in this surah are reflections of Allah's grace and His mercy upon humanity or upon His creations. So that is why this surah is beginning with Ar-Rahman, to show that it is because Allah is Ar-Rahman that all these things have been created. It is because Allah is Ar-Rahman why He is treating His servants, His creations in different ways, according to their actions, according to their deeds. So this Ar-Rahman with which this surah begins has a very close relationship with what is being said in this surah. Then we also see some tabi'un even including Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, have pointed out that this Ar-Rahman is from three different verses with which surahs begin. When you see some surahs beginning with Alif, Lam, Ra, there are five surahs in the Quran which begin with Alif, Lam, Ra, like Surah Yunus, Surah Hud, Surah Yusuf, Surah Ibrahim, and Surah Hijr. These five surahs begin with Alif, Lam, Ra. Then we find another seven surahs in the Quran beginning with Ha, Mim. And those seven surahs come one after the other, from surah number 40 to surah number 46. All those surahs begin with Ha, Mim. And then there is one surah in the Quran which begins with Noon. That is Surah Al-Qalam. Noon wal-qalami wama yasturun. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and some other tabi'un, they are of the opinion that these three letters or these three collection of letters together constitute this word Ar-Rahman, which shows that Allah's Rahmah is not confined to any particular place or any particular surah and so on, but it covers the entire Quran. It offers all His guidance to humanity. Then also we spoke about this Ar-Rahman and we said that all Allah's attributes and all His actions and all what He does in this world come from this attribute which is related to Ar-Rahman. Whatever Allah does in this world, it is through His Rahmah. It is through His Rahmah. So when you read this surah, we said that there is one particular verse which has been repeated over and over again. And what was that verse? Which of Allah's blessings do you falsify? Which of Allah's blessings do you falsify? So which means that Allah has showered us with abundance of blessings which are the result of His mercy, of His grace. Had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not cared about us, He would not have any love and affection for us, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have given us so many blessings. So that is how we should understand Ar-Rahman. Then we told that the other three verses that follow were ayah number 2, 3 and 4 speak about three of these blessings which are related to human beings. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created man, and not just created him, but created him in the best of forms, shows Allah's blessings upon mankind. His creation is perfect. We cannot find a different form for human beings better than the form that we are. We cannot find it. Because Allah has created us in the best of forms. We cannot change anything in our creation. Then we also see that Allah has not only created, but He has also taught him eloquence, how to express himself. And expressing oneself is an essential quality for a human being to live on this earth. If he cannot express himself, he will face a lot of difficulties and a lot of problems. And he will not even be able to pronounce Allah's blessings. As Allah says, فَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. With regard to Allah's ni'mah, Allah's blessings upon you, what should you do? You should speak about it. You should tell the other people about it. You should remind them that Allah has given you all these blessings. Don't keep it to yourself. Show the other people that Allah is blessing His servants. So, فَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. So how can we say, how can we talk, how can we mention them if we cannot express ourselves? So this faculty of expression is in itself one of the greatest blessings. And it is through this that Allah was able to convey His message, His book of guidance to humanity. Which is what Allah says, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. He taught the Qur'an. So therefore the scholars of tafsir say that these three blessings are the highest and the best of all the blessings Allah has bestowed human beings. That is the ni'mah of hidayat, the ni'mah of guidance, the ni'mah of khalq, the blessing of creation, and number three, the ni'mah of bayan. Allamahu al-bayan, expression. So these were what we went through last week. So today we come to the next section, which speaks about Allah's creations other than mankind. Now we are going to the universe to see what are Allah's signs in the universe. So how does Allah begin? He says, "Ash-shamsu wal-qamaru bi-husban." Ash-shamsu wal-qamaru bi-husban. Shams, we all know, that's the sun. Al-qamar, we all know, it is the moon. Ash-shams wal-qamar. Then we see the word bi-husban. Bi-husban. Husban comes from the word hasiba. Hasiba has two meanings. One is to count, to enumerate. Number two is to think. To think. So husban means to count, to calculate. So Allah is saying that the sun and the moon both have been created perfectly, perfectly, in measured quality, quantity, activity, and everything. Everything related to the creation of the sun and the moon have been meticulously planned. So, Ash-shams wal-qamaru bi-husban. Here Allah is saying that number one, these two are some of Allah's greatest signs. It is true that we always see them in our lives. We have got used to them. We are very familiar. But we fail to think about what is behind the functioning of the sun and the moon. We fail to realize the importance and the necessity of the sun and the moon for human life. We get it free and we have got used to it. So we don't understand how it is going to be without it. Nor do we understand that it is because of the perfection with which this sun and the moon function that we are able to benefit from it. Because if you look in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in almost 18 places has mentioned the sun and the moon together. Sun and the moon together. Because they are the closest of all the celestial bodies in the sky. So, why has Allah mentioned about this sun and the moon? Because they are signs to us. They are signs. In the sense that they will guide us to the Creator who created them. But do we remember the Creator when we see the sun or when we see the moon? No, we don't. But Allah is saying, they have been created so that they will guide you towards the Creator. In this surah, Surah Fussilat, Allah is saying in verse 37, and of His sign, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارُ وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ. Nighttime, daytime, sun, the moon, are all from among Allah's signs. Then again Allah is saying in chapter 30, verse 22, and of His signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَوْ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The creation of heavens and the earth are of Allah's signs. So Allah's signs have been placed in various places in the universe. On the earth, in the sky, in the sun and the moon. So what is the purpose? The purpose is to guide people towards their Creator. Now look at the verses which came before this. Which came before. What were those verses? Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Quran, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. Allah created us and gave us a perfect form. He gave us the power, ability of expression, and He sent down His book and made all arrangements that were needed for that book to be taught to us. But even with all that, Allah did not leave us. He also created in the universe so many things that will also help us find our way to Allah. So He created the sun and the moon and the stars and the earth and the plants and so on. So all these creations have been created for a purpose. For a purpose. And that is, it is that purpose that Allah is mentioning here. But the problem is, when all these creations understand the purpose of their creation and act accordingly, there is no creation which disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except man or the jinn. But human beings fail to understand this. Human beings fail to understand this. So, even though man, he derives various benefits from the sun and the moon and other creations, he does not understand the real purpose, why they have been created and why they have been made to function the way we see them function. If we look at the sun and the moon, we are able to see some scientific facts, like the sun. It is more than a million times bigger than the earth. Then we see that the flames of the sun stretch a million miles, that is at the surface, but when you go inside it will stretch as far, it will be as powerful as 6000 degrees, the heat of the sun. Then also we see that the distance between the sun and the earth, it is something very big. We cannot imagine 156 million kilometers. That is something Really amazing. What is the longest distance that we have traveled? Maybe some thousands of kilometers if we have flown to some foreign country. If we had traveled all around this earth, we would have traveled how long? About 24,000 miles or 40,000 kilometers. So that is all the distance we know, we are accustomed to. But when you look at the sun and the earth, we see that the distance between them is not just thousands, it's 156 million. When 1 million is equals to 100,000 or 1,000 times 1,000. So it is something very great, very much, very big. But this is the distance between the earth and the sun. But is the sun that we see the only sun that is there? No. We all know that. We know that there are billions of suns in the galaxy. Billions of suns. And those suns are more powerful than the sun that we have. More powerful. What is it? Pardon? Stars. Stars are the sun. Stars are solar systems. So I don't know whether the sun is also called a star. It is a star. Yeah. So this sun and the moon are some amazing creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with that you look at the speed with which they function. Therefore, when you look at the sun and the moon and all the other stars and planets and everything that you see, we can note that they have been created with precise calculation. Very precisely. The earth is turning on its axis. And do you know the speed? It's about 1,000 miles per hour. 1,000 miles per hour, because to turn one complete round, how long does it take? A day. So a day has 24 hours. And we said that the circumference of the earth is 24,000 miles. So therefore, it has to travel at a speed, or it has to turn, spin at a speed of 1,000 miles approximately per hour. So 1,000 miles per hour. Can you imagine how fast it is? But we can't feel anything. This is how Allah has created them. And it is also moving fast in its orbit around the sun. And do you know how fast that is? It is 60,000 miles per hour. 60,000 miles per hour. Then the entire solar system is moving in one direction. The entire solar system is moving in one direction. And that is estimated to be 20,000 miles per hour. So it's something terrific. Everything is moving very fast. The entire solar system, and do you know the size of the solar system? We just spoke about the distance between the sun and the earth. What about the other planets? And they are all moving fast at the speed of 20,000 kilometers towards a particular direction. But even then, they do not collide with other stars in the galaxy. They do not collide. So how is it? When we go at 100 kilometers per hour in a road where there is traffic, you can't do it. But all these are moving fast, but they are not knocking on each other. And it so happens that if the solar system comes to close to any other solar system, any other star, it could burn the entire solar system because of the power of those stars over the our sun. But that is also not happening. And when we look at the distance between the earth and the sun, we see that it has been precisely placed so that if it goes a little away, everything will freeze. When it comes closer, everything will scorch. And we see this, the earth is not turning straight, it is slanted. And we see that it doesn't turn in a circle. It comes around the, its orbit is not circle, it is in the oval shaped. Yes. All these have been precisely planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to maintain the balance between different climates, between different seasons, between the day and night, so that all the places will be able to experience day and night. Had it been turning straight, some places would never have seen day and some places would have never seen night. So this is the preciseness which Allah is mentioning here. Ash-shamsu wal-qamaru bihusban. Precisely calculated and kept. The size, the speed, the direction, everything have been precisely calculated. Then what else is Allah saying? Wan-najmu wash-shajaru yasjudan. Najm is what? Stars. Ash-shajar is the plural of shajara. Shajara means tree. A shajar is trees. A najm you can use as singular and also as plural, but there is a singular najma, najmatun, najma, and najm can be the plural. So a najm was shajar. Allah is mentioning about the stars and the trees. What do they do? Yes, juda. Yes, juda. They are prostrate. Now here, an-najm has been described as something other than the stars by some companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including stars. There are other Arabic words also which do not mention stars, but najm is the most popular of them. But there are companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially the companions who did tafsir for the Quran, they say that najm means trees that do not have trunks and branches, like creepers, small plants, grass, etc. So Allah is speaking about those small plants and the big trees, all of them. But this is not the popular opinion amongst all. There are other scholars like Sufyan al-Thawri and Mujahid, Qatada, and so on. They also famous mufassirs who commented on the verses of the Quran. They are of the opinion that it could mean those grasses and creepers, but we do not need to negate the meaning stars, because before this Allah is speaking about the sun and the moon, so it is natural that after that he will speak about the stars. So it's not a problem to us, because in the end they are all Allah's creations. They are all Allah's creations. What Allah is saying here is what is important. What are these stars and trees doing? They are prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do they prostrate? We don't know. There are many tafsir, scholars of tafsir give different interpretations. Some say when the sun is shining, when the sun rises, the tree or the plants turn towards that sun, and that may be the sujood. Some others say no, it's the shade that these trees give, that is what is the sujood. So many interpretations are given, but in some way or the other, in some form or the other, all these creations are doing sujood to Allah. Because what is sujood? Sujood is to prostrate. What is prostrating? What do? You place your head on the ground. Now what does it mean to place your head on the ground? Complete submission. Complete submission. You do not place any might or any power or any supremacy, superiority. You do not attribute it to yourself. You give everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means, as Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدُ. The closest a servant is to his creator when he is in the sujood position. So you are closest to Allah when you do sujood, which means all these creations are moving closer and closer to Allah. So why is Allah saying this? Same thing that He said before. We created you in the best of forms. We gave you the power, ability of expression. We gave you guidance. Why? So that you will be guided to Allah. So that you go towards Allah. So that you get nearer and closer to Allah. And that is what the entire universe is doing. Just as you have been created precisely and perfectly, all the other creations in the universe have been created perfectly and precisely. But do they transgress? Do they disobey? Do they go beyond their bounds? Do they refuse to do what they have been expected to do? No. They are all doing sujood. They are all completely submitting themselves to their creator. So why are you, O man, not doing what these creations are doing, even though you have been blessed with intellect, mind, thought, sight, and so on? Allah's ayat, Allah's signs are there, not only in the Quran, not only in these verses, but also in the universe which is surrounding you. But even with all those signs, you are unable to be grateful to Allah as much as all these creations are. So that is why Allah is mentioning. So, Al-Najmu wa Shajaru yasjuda. Okay. Then Allah is saying, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانَ. Allah raised the skies. Allah raised the skies. وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانَ. Mizan means balance. The weighing scale is called mizan. We know that. Asama is sky. Rafa'a is to raise. Wada'a is to place or to keep something. To place something, wada'a. To keep it, wada'a. So He raised the sky and He placed the balance. Here again, there is some scientific fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about, but we are yet to determine what it really means. The fact that Allah has raised the skies without any pillars in such a manner that it will create an ideal environment for us to live on this earth. It protects us from the excess heat of the sun. Similarly, the sky is what brings us rain, and so on. So many things have been planned by merely placing the sky above us in a precise distance. So, as-samaa rafa'aha, Allah has raised the skies above us. And He has not just raised those skies, but He has also placed a balance between them. So, what this balance is, and what is meant by raising the skies, are scientific facts that are yet to be determined. But what we need to realize, what we need to understand is, that when we try to connect between scientific facts and the Quran. Scientific facts and the Quran. We need not think that it is only if these ayat or these verses could be proved by such scientific facts that it is a miracle and it is proof. No. Even without it, if a layman, a person who is not knowledgeable, if he just gazes or directs his vision towards these natural creations, he will be able to feel that these are functioning because of a powerful creator who is behind. So, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانَ. Allah is speaking about a balance that He has maintained among His creations. Then Allah is telling people, أَلَّا تَتْغَوْا فِي الْمِيزَانِ. Now here what I have said is that this balance which Allah has created, we could read it as a balance within that creation and a balance without that creation, which means this balance could be seen as a balance among the creation itself, among the skies, among the stars, and so on. It could also be a balance between the creation of the skies, the creation of the suns, and the creation of man. That all what Allah has created for man, He has created it them in a balanced form. So here there are some similarities between the universe and between man. Number one, the universe has been created for a purpose. And we know that man, he does not live without a purpose. He cannot do any work without a purpose. Number two is anything that happens in the universe, there will be a reason for it. Why this happened like this? Why that happened like this? If this happens, that will happen. There is a reason for everything. Similarly, in human beings, they always try to reason. They always try to find out how things happen and why things happen and work accordingly. If they know that the fire burns, then they will not touch it because they know that the reason why their hand is burning is because the fire burns. So things like that man has that power, man can do. But not only man, even the other creations, they have a reason for their function. And number three, we see that none of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the stars, the skies, the sun, there is no contradiction. That is what we saw in Surah Al-Mulk, where Allah is saying, هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُتُور مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَانِ مِنْ تَفَاوَتْ. You will not see in the خَلْقُ الرَّحْمَانِ. That is what Allah is speaking here. خَلْقُ الرَّحْمَانِ. The creations of the merciful, the creations of the Lord of grace. You will never see any flaws. Everything will be perfect, perfectly planned. So there will not be any contradictions in these creations. So similarly, Allah is expecting from human beings that they will not have any contradictions. And it's man's nature that he does not like anything to contradict. So these are some similarities that can be observed between the universal creations and between the human beings. Then Allah is saying, Allah tatghaw fil mizan. Now He has spoken about the mizan which is in the universe. Now He is directing His speech to the people and saying, you do not transgress. You do not go beyond your bounds. You do not fail to observe that balance which is found in every place of the universe. Everywhere you turn in the universe, you find a complete balance, equilibrium, and so on. But only in your life, we do not see that. So it is your duty to maintain this balance. Now what is this balance? What is this balance? This balance can mean so many things. It is not confined to one particular aspect of our life. If you look at your ibadah, then there should be balance. If you look at your family life, then there should be balance. If you look at your business, your work, your recreation, there should be a balance. Every aspect of your life, a balance should be maintained. Just as that balance is maintained everywhere in the universe. But man fails to maintain that balance. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when speaking about ibadah, when speaking about worship, He is speaking about Friday prayers. What does He say? When you are called for Friday prayers, on the day of Jummah, you rush to prayers. Rush to prayers. But once the prayers are over, what does He say? Once the prayers are over, you spread, disperse on earth and seek your sustenance, the rizq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here is a balance between worship and between finding our livelihood. Allah does not expect a person to spend his time continuously in the mosque. Then we also see in human life, especially men, we have a big challenge of maintaining balance in our life, our place of work, our homes, and so on. Sometimes we pay more attention and spend more time in our places of work, and we spend less time with our family. But here, there should be a balance maintained. We should not neglect one side and pay more attention to the other side. So here is another balance. Sometimes among our children, we may not give them balanced attention. We will pay more attention to one child and less attention to the other. Similarly, when we have the way we treat our wives, we may look into certain needs of that wife, but we will neglect so many other needs. So this balance should be maintained in every aspect of his life. Even when dealing with non-Muslims. Some will say that kafirs are your enemies until the day of judgment. There is no way that you can work with them, you can be with them, you can do what they do, and so on. Some will say, no, they are creations. We have to give hidayat to them. So we have to be as close as possible to them. So we have to do as much as possible whatever they do, so that they will come close to us. So here we see that extreme and this extreme. So there should be a balance maintained between the two. So Islam guides people by showing them the balanced approach, the balanced way of life. And it is the same balance that can be seen in all parts of the universe, all over the world. So Allah is saying, whatever you do, whichever way of life you choose, you live a balanced way of life. Allah tathraw fil mizan, never transgress over that balance. Then Allah is coming to a more specific form of that balance, which is al-qist. Wa aqimul wazna bil qisti wa la tukhsirul mizan. What is the value you give to something? What is the value you give to something? In Islamic fiqh, in Islamic Sharia, there is a fiqh called fiqhul awlawiyyat. Fiqhul awlawiyyat, which means the fiqh of preference, of priority. You should know how to prioritize all your work. You should know what should get first attention and what should get less attention, what should get more attention, and so on. You should know to prioritize your work. So give each and every work its due value, its due place. Don't give more attention than it is needed for some particular aspect of your life. So وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ, establish weight, establish value in a just manner. Just manner. Qist means just. In so many places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when speaking about the purpose why He sent His messengers, He will say, لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ, so that the people will learn to be treated justly, or to treat the people justly. So, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. Again Allah is saying, do not deficient the balance. That means, do not transgress the balance. Transgress means to either to go more or to go less. So don't give less value than it is needed. Don't give more value than it is needed. But maintain a balance, because that is what is just. So maintaining justice is another form of maintaining the balance in our life. And it was this justice for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent all the prophets, in order to maintain justice on earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. Al-Adl, one of the names of Allah, one of the attributes of Allah is He is the most just. So similarly, Qist, both are same. Both are same. Qist also comes in Allah's names. Muqsit. Muqsit. Very close meanings both have. So, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. So, here mizan is being repeated. In this surah alone, we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thrice He repeats this mizan. Because all the secret behind all creations is this mizan. If you want something to function properly, then there should be a balance maintained between. That is what we see in the solar system. That is what we see in the cycle of the plants, the way they get food, the way they give fruits, and so on. That is what we see in the cycle of rain, and in all creations. So why is it that human beings are unable to maintain that balance? And it is in order to show him the way of maintaining that balance that the prophets were sent, in order to treat the people with justice. Then Allah is saying, وَالْأَرْضَ وَضَأَهَا لِلْأَنَامِ. One section Allah has spoken about the universe. Now Allah is speaking about a different aspect. Al-Ard, the earth. Why has He laid the earth? Just for zina? Just as a source of beautification? No. He has placed the earth in such a manner that it will help man to live. وَالْأَرْضَ وَضَعَهَا لِلْأَنَامِ. Anam, what is Anam? Anam does not only mean human beings. Anam means all creations, including insects and all living creatures. They are all called Anam. So Allah has created the earth for all creatures. All creatures, all living creations on the face of the earth. How has He created that earth? Allah is saying, فِيهَا فَاكِهَةٌ وَالنَّخْلُ ذَاتُ الْأَكْمَامِ. Number one, Allah has made fakiha, fruits on that earth. Then He has created palm trees. And those palm trees give you fruit, not just one and two and three. No, they give in large numbers, sheaths of dates. Fakiha is fruit. Nakhl is date palm. Zat is an Arabic term that is used to show relativity. That is, if a person has wealth, we say Rajulun Dhu Mali. And if it is feminine, Imra'atun Zatu Jamali. A woman with beauty, we will say Imra'atun Zatu Jamali. A woman who has beauty. So here Allah is saying, a date palm which has what? Zatu al-akmam. What is akmam? Akmam means sheaths. Like you see in plantains, the way the plantains. Similarly, in date palms also, Allah has created dates to come in plenty, large numbers, sheaths. Then Allah is also saying, wal-habbu dhul-asbi wal-rayhan. Not only the fruits and the date palm, because dates are in some aspects something different from fruits, because fruits are not regarded as a wholesome food. Fruits are not regarded as wholesome food, whereas dates are regarded as wholesome food, which has all the nutrition that is needed for human beings. So Allah has differentiated between fruits and the dates. Then here Allah is saying, Walhab. What is Al-Hab? Al-Hab is grains. Zu, earlier it spoke about it. Zu means relativity. Zat is feminine. Zu is masculine. So there Allah was speaking about Nakhil. Nakhil is a feminine word. So here Al-Hab, grain, it is a masculine word. So Allah is using Zu. So Al-Habbudul Asf. Asf is the husk. Husk. So grains with husk, so that it could be protected. It could be protected from germs, it could be protected from any external things that could damage it, and so on. So Walhabbudul Asf. Allah has created grains in husks, and also created a raihan. Raihan are plants that have beautiful smell. So all this Allah has created on earth and laid the earth. Why? So that we will be able to live on it. So it is for you that we have created this entire universe. And it is you who we have created in the best of forms. And it is for you that we have given the guidance in the form of the book and the form of our science in the universe. And with all that mercy and affection and grace that Allah has shown upon man, he is unable to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is saying, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَا. Which of Allah's favors, or which of the favors of your Lord do you deny? Allah, the word Allah, Allah means blessings, favors. But there are some other meanings which have been given to this word, Allah. Blessings, power and virtue. These are three meanings that have been given by the scholars of Tafsir. Because there are some places, sometimes when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah does not directly speak about the benefits he has made for man, but he speaks about the greatness of his creation. So at such times, the word Allah could mean power. So which of Allah's powers do you deny? And then it could also mean virtue. And this meaning also has been mentioned by some scholars of Tafsir. Virtue in the sense of characteristics, qualities, and so on. So which of Allah's virtues, qualities, do you deny? So these are some meanings that have been given for Allah. And depending on the context where Allah is speaking about Allah, we have to take the required and relevant meanings. Then what is Allah meaning by denial? Which of Allah's blessings, favors do you deny? What is denial? Denial does not just mean that you say, no, Allah has not given me any favors. That's not what denial is all about. Denial could also mean that you do not accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as your creator. But there are some people who accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as their Lord and as their creator, but they do not thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what he has created for man, for the blessings. They are not thankful, they are not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are some other people who may thank Allah, who may accept Allah, but when you look at their lives, they do not act obediently to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not obey Allah. They do not act according to the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects them to live. So denial of Allah's blessings, denial of Allah's favors could come in different forms. You could be ungrateful, you could simply deny, or you could deny through your actions. If you are negligent in prayers, actually you are denying Allah's favors. Why? Because if you are really grateful and thankful to Allah for His favors, when He is calling you, you will rush towards Him. But you are not doing that. So this is one form of denial. Then also we see another form of denial is that you do not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not attribute any form of blessings that you get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You thank some other people. You show your gratitude to some other person. You respect them. But you forget that it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who helped you, who blessed you through that man. So here again, you are denying the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this denial can come in various forms. So now we see, beginning from this ayah, verse number 13, again and again in this surah, the same verse is being repeated. And in between these verses, Allah is describing various forms of His favors to not only the human beings, but also to the jinn. Now, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed this surah in such a form? Mention a blessing and ask a question. Mention a blessing and ask a question. We have created you like this, so why are you denying our favors? We have done this, so why are you denying our favors? Why is Allah using this style of in this surah? So here the scholars of tafsir point out that this is because of the time when this surah was revealed. According to many scholars of tafsirs, this was revealed in the latter part of the Meccan year. That means the second half of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's da'wah in Mecca. So it was a time when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions had followed several ways in trying to convince the kafirs, the Quraysh, about Allah and about our need to obey Him. But they would not accept. So there are different forms of convincing someone or making someone to believe something, and among them is to repeat something over and over again. You see, sometimes the parents, when they speak to the children, you will have to tell the child 10-15 times before he or she goes and does it. So each time your tone is different, and sometimes you will add some things in between. You will say, if you don't do this, I won't give you this. Or you will say, I gave you this, no, so now you go and do that, and so on. So repeating something over and over again is a way that you use when you are dealing with people who are stubborn. So when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that these people were adamant, they were stubborn, they will never listen to Allah's call, then Allah is using or bringing a different approach in the way He is speaking to mankind. So He reveals this surah in this form. So again and again Allah is posing the question, which of the favors of your Lord do you deny? So here Ibn Qutaybah, he says that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recounts all His blessings in the surah and reminds His servants of His bounties and warns them of His power and ability, all which was mentioned, He has put this clause as a separation between His favors and blessings in order to make them understand and comprehend it, as well as to affirm and emphasize it. Number one, Allah warns us to understand the different blessings that He is giving us, the favors He is giving us. And number two, He wants us to emphasize it, to affirm it, not to deny it. So because of this, Allah is repeating them over and over again. Then Allah is, after speaking about the earth, He is now coming to the creation of man once again. But now He is speaking about out of which man has been created. He is saying, خلق الإنسان, He created man, من صلصال كالفخار. Salsal is a form of clay. He created man from clay like that of pottery. Fakhar is something which makes a sound when you tap. When you tap a clay pot, it makes a sound. That is what is called fakhar. Kal fakhar. So salsal is a form of clay which when it dries, it will make a sound. So salsal made out of clay, which is like pottery. Now when we see, look at the Quran, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran speaks about various forms of the clay with which man was created. In various stages He speaks about different. First Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about creating man with turab. Turab means dust, sand, dust. Then Allah speaks about creating man with teen. So teen is the turab when it is mixed with water. Then Allah speaks about creating man with teen lazib, min teenin lazib. Lazib means to stick. So a clay which sticks. So when you mix the sand with water and leave it for some time, it will become sticky when it is got dissolved nicely. Then when you leave that for some more time, it begins to stink. So that is what Allah has saying, min hamaim masnoon, a clay which stinks. So all this show the various stages that pass through during the creation of man. Then it comes up to when Allah is saying bashar, and then He is speaking about the sperm. So all these are different forms that the creation of man went through before he came into being. So all these different forms of clay were there only at the beginning of man's creation. Later on today, no creation is going to take the form of clay, and we are not going to see any human beings coming out of clay. But this was at the beginning. Only Adam alayhi salam. From Adam alayhi salam onwards, man comes through the sperm. So what Allah is meaning by this creation is the creation of Adam alayhi salam. Similarly, when Allah is speaking about the jinn, He is saying, وَخَلَقَ الْجَانَّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنَّا. We created the jinn from a smokeless flame of fire. Marij is a particular form of nar. Nar is fire, we all know that. Marij is one particular kind of fire. A kind which is very clear and which has no smoke. It is very clear and it has no smoke. It is from such a type of fire that Allah created what? Al-Jan. Jan is the plural of jinn. Jinn. So we create, just as we created man out of clay, we created the jinns out of marjim minar, a particular kind of, just as Allah described the form of clay, here Allah is describing the form of fire. So here we see that the jinns, number one, they are not mere spirits which don't have any physical form. No, jinns also have a physical form. But the fact is that because they were made out of fire and not out of clay, clay takes a particular shape, whereas fire does not retain a particular shape. The jinns too are able to take different shapes and forms at different times. Then we also see that the jinn is not part of human beings, or it does not come under the species of human beings. It is a completely different creation, because people have been created with clay and the jinn have been created with fire. So these distinctions can be found. So because man has been created with clay and jinn has been created with fire, we see that there are some essential differences in the qualities of those creations. Man could always be soft humble, lenient, and so on. Whereas the jinns could be very aggressive, strong, angry, and so on. So these come because of because of what they were created with. Then Allah is again saying, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Which of Allah's creations do you deny? Then finally Allah is saying, رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقَيْنِ وَرَبُّ الْمَغْرِبِ. Now these are the verses that speak about the universe. So finally in this series Allah is saying, رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقَيْنِ وَرَبُّ الْمَغْرِبِ. That Allah spoke about the universe, the sun, the moon, the stars and plants and so on. Then He spoke about man and jinn. And now He is speaking about the Creator Himself. Who created all this universe? Allah is saying, رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقَيْنِ وَرَبُّ الْمَغْرِبِ. Allah is the creator of the two sunrises and He is the creator of the two sunsets. What is the two sunrises and what is the two sunsets? Again, there are different interpretations given by the scholars of Tafsir. But we take only two out of them. Number one, the two sunrises and the two sunsets could mean the different places where the sun rises from and the sun sets during different climates. In the winter, it will rise from one place. In the summer, it will rise from another place. We have noticed the direction from where the sun rises changes. Similarly, from where it sets, that's also changes. So the beginning of the one end of the place where the sun rises is one place of sunrise, and the one end of the place where the sun sets is one sunset. So there are two sunrises and two sunsets. Some say that this is not sunrise. Mashriq could be the place from where anything rises, even the moon. So they say because Allah is speaking about the sun and the moon at the beginning of this surah, it could mean the places from where the sun rises and the moon rises, and the places where the sun sets and the moon goes down. So anyway, Allah is saying, who is the person, what is the power that is making this happen without any fault? There is no time when the sun or the moon came or went at any time that is not its time. Now we cannot see the sun delaying even a second or even a minute from the due time it should rise. Every day it's happening according to the specific time. Now how can this accuracy be maintained? Because they are maintained not naturally. They are not things that happen on their own, because Allah is the one who is activating them. Allah is the one who is making them function, because He is the Lord of the two sunrises and the two sunsets. And it is because of this sunrise and the sunset that man is able to live on this earth. If there was no sunrise and no sunset, if there was no moon, because the moon is also equally important as the sun. It maintains the levels of the tides, the level of water. It maintains the magnetic power between the earth and the atmosphere and so on. So the moon is also equally important. And Allah is saying, we are behind the functioning of the sun and the moon. So فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So which of Allah's blessings, favors, do you deny? So here this surah is making us think a lot, making us ponder over Allah's signs. Why has Allah created this? Why has Allah created it in such a manner? And behind all this we see the beauty of Allah's creations, that they are created with a balance. And which is why Allah expects us to always deal with others justly and not to be unjust towards others, not to be unjust towards ourselves and not to be unjust towards others. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us maintain this balance in our lives And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us deal justly in all our affairs. May He accept all our deeds, guide us in our life, and bless us with all the blessings that He bestows His creations. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins, forgive the sins of all our relations and the Muslim Ummah. May Allah relieve our community and the Muslims living all over the world from all hardships, all problems. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard the lives of the Muslims, the women, the youth, and the property of the Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring peace and tranquility. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our du'as. Ameen wa akhir da'wana. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.